Well, today's message is on the book of Proverbs again. We've been in a series over the last few weeks called Proverbs, Wisdom for Everyday Life. And today we're going to be taking a look at wisdom and folly. And in order to do that, I thought I would give you some visual illustrations of the two scripture passages that we've got hanging here on the bumper. We kind of talk about Proverbs as being like bumper stickers. They're short, pithy sayings that kind of remind you of God's truth. And there's a way for us to memorize them easily enough because they're short and they're easy to memorize. I would encourage you, if you want to grow in your wisdom, read the book of Proverbs. The first part is a wisdom passed on from a father to his children. The second part is about wisdom for everyday life. And the third part is about wisdom and leadership. It's just a fantastic book, short little one sentence, two sentence sayings on wisdom. Now, the interpretation of Proverbs, because we want to make sure you do this correctly, is that not every proverb is true all the time. In general, they're true. They're wise sayings, right? So we don't always believe the wise saying all the time because the circumstances are different. I shared with you a while ago that my dad put a little old proverb above my bed that said, the hurrier I go, the behinder I get. Well, that was generally true of me then, but it's not generally true of me now. So the proverbs spoke to a truth that I needed to hear. And they can often be interpreted as helpful along your journey. So I've asked a couple of volunteers to help me out with this, but I need two additional volunteers. I would love it if some kids would be able to help me with this. Andrew, would you be willing to help me with this? Can you come up here and help me with this? Anyone else? Let me see here. Would you like to help me? Can you help me? All right, you come up here, both of you guys. Now, you guys have to be really strong, okay? Because what I want you to do is I want you to hold on to this end. Can you hold on to that end? Now, I want you to hold on to this end and make sure I get this right in here. Okay, now face everybody. You go around there, Andrew. Ready? All right, so you guys hold still while I pull back, okay? You ready? Wait, okay, all right. Well, maybe we should aim it a little better, right? All right, ready? You guys ready? Hold on still. Ready? Oh, wait a minute, let's try that again. Okay, ready? Here we go, here we go. Oh, that doesn't work very well, does it? You thought it was funny. Okay, guys, put it up here on the table. Here's one of the proverbs for today. You guys can go sit down. Ready? All right. I should have had this ready in my hand quickly, but I don't have it ready. Proverbs 26. Verse 7 says this, a proverb in the mouth of a fool is useless as a paralyzed leg, or in the Message version, which I have in my Bible here. Honoring a fool is as foolish as tying a stone to a slingshot. So we don't want to honor fools, and a slingshot's no good if you tie the stone to it. I've got another illustration here that I want to show you, and I've asked Gary and I've asked Adam to come up here for a minute. All right, so I'm just going to let you pick which one. So this says nothing about either one of you, okay? Which one do you want?
I wanted that one.
You wanted that one? All right, now one is a list of proverbs that describes a fool, and one is a list of proverbs that describes a wise man. All right, so Gary, where are those two mics for me for a minute? If you guys would just mind grabbing these mics, and we're going to turn these back on again, guys, at the back, if you wouldn't mind. And so Gary, I'd like for you to read the first one for me.
Proverbs 13:22. A good man leaves an inheritance to his children's children, but the sinner's wealth is laid up for the righteous.
You get to have one of these. Take one of those out of here, will you? All right. Adam, would you read one?
Proverbs 29:9. If a wise man has an argument with a fool, the fool only rages and laughs, and there is no quiet.
You get to take one of these. Go ahead, read the next one.
Proverbs 21:20. precious treasure are oil, and oil are in a wise man's dwelling, but a foolish man devours it.
Good wise man stores up things. There we go. All right.
Proverbs 28:26. Whoever trusts in his own mind is a fool, but he who walks in wisdom will be delivered.
Uh-oh, there's another foolish one there. Take another. Wet noodle.
Proverbs 18:15. And an intelligent heart acquires knowledge, and the ear of the wise seeks knowledge.
Oh, see, look at that. Yeah, what wisdom going on there, yeah.
Proverbs 14:15. The simple believes everything.
Yep, like a wet noodle. All right.
Proverbs 17:27. Whoever restrains his words has knowledge, and he who has a cool spirit is a man of understanding.
Well, we want to be a man of understanding. There's wisdom there, yeah.
Proverbs 15:20. A wise son makes a glad father, but a foolish man despises his mother.
Uh-oh. I don't want to be a wet noodle and despise your mother.
Proverbs 2:6. For the Lord gives wisdom, from his mouth come knowledge and understanding, for sure.
All right. God gives wisdom to the wise.
Proverbs 18:6. A fool's lips walks into a fight, and his mouth invites a beating.
Oh.
That's good.
Proverbs 12:1. Whoever loves discipline loves knowledge, but he who hates reproof is stupid.
Go wisdom.
I know.
Proverbs 26:19. Is the man who deceives his neighbor and says, I am only joking.
There's another fool there. Just a joke.
And Proverbs 3:7. Be not wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and turn away from evil.
Be wise, not in your eyes. And the last one?
Proverbs 26:7. A proverb quoted by fools is limp and as a wet noodle.
Thank you, gentlemen. You can throw these back in here. You can have a seat. You can take those if you want. All right, thanks, guys. Thank you for illustrating for me a couple of these passages. Foolishness is not something that you want to have regularly in your life. I mean, we've all had a chance to be foolish at times, right? There are things that we've done that we wish that we hadn't. There are people that we hang out with that we wish that we didn't. And foolishness can get us into trouble. The Bible, though, intends for us to be wise. It intends for us to be wise enough to understand and discern what's going on in the world around us. How many of you want to be wise? Yeah. How many of you want to be a fool? Oh, there's a couple of you who just did that for me. You, a fool is just as wise as a wet noodle. I don't know. The intention behind the book of Proverbs is to point towards wisdom and to warn against foolishness. And the idea behind being wise has to get its point from somewhere. It gets its meaning and its beginning in the beginning of the book of Proverbs. And the idea is for you to gain wisdom and advice for your everyday life, to move forward in your wisdom, to be able to say, you know what, I want to make wise choices and wise decisions in my life. And what's true in the realm of medicine and construction and physics and accounting and sports is also true when it comes to other dimensions of your life as well. We know that there are certain principles that applied mathematics have. We know that there are certain principles in accounting and in sports and in medicine that if you follow them, you will be wise or the outcome will be positive. But there are similar rules and there are similar principles for our regular everyday life. For some reason, many of us think that we can make our own rules or we can make our own decisions and not seek wisdom when we live with all of these principles and rules throughout the rest of our lives. Some principles are intuitive. We just kind of know that we shouldn't do stuff like that. right? Sorry, my phone seems to be having a fit here, so. I don't know. Sorry, what was that? That's right, yeah, a wise person should turn off their phone before we get going. Have a noodle, yeah. I should go back to the noodle pot there for a second. We want to make wise choices. We don't want to go to the noodle pot. You know, we want to be able to be seen by other people as being wise. You know that there's this person in your life. There is that person, someone that you've gone to in the past, someone that you would pick up the phone and call in the future. That's a wise person that you would seek advice from. We want to be that person. We want to have that kind of relationship with our kids and our grandkids. We want to have that relationship with our fellow employers where they come to us because they know we can give them wise advice for daily living. Where does it come from? Where do we get this wisdom from? And it gets back to the very same thing we've talked about the first time we spoke about Proverbs and last time that we spoke about Proverbs, and it's our understanding that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Now, over the last couple of weeks, some of you have come to me and given me some real pushback with that word fear, right? Because when I say the word fear, you think afraid or scared. When I think of fear, you think of a trauma in your life where you were trembling or that you were scared to death about some situation. But when I use the word fear in relationship to God, it also has another meaning. It doesn't always mean afraid. The word fear also means to respect and to honor something. If I know who God is in my life, and I know that there are principles that He has applied to the universe that are true, that are true, that are true. If I go to my surgeon and he's been drinking, I don't want to put a scalpel in his hand. That's a truism that I would want to make sure is absolutely true about my surgeon, that he's not been drinking before he does the surgery. I mean, that's just wise. But there are other things in the universe that God has ordained that are also wisdom. And they come from understanding that God might actually have some wisdom for you in making the major decisions of your life that you don't have yet. And when you recognize that He is God and that you're not, and that He has a plan for the universe and a plan for your body and He has a plan for physics and He has a plan for accounting and He has a plan for sports, all of these things there's a plan for, there seem to be principles involved in this, maybe, just maybe, that there are wise principles that God has for you for the rest of your life. And when we finally recognize that God is God, I'm the creation, He is the creator, He is the author of the universe, I am His subject, He is master, I am a servant, then maybe we should be going to Him and asking Him, Lord, what do we do? How do we live this life? How do we do stuff and be wise about it? Well, I want to take it one step further. How can you expect your life to become a masterpiece, to be the life that you want it to be, to go down the road that you want to go down without making all the mistakes that happen that other people have made, unless we are willing, in the fear of the Lord, to subject or to submit ourselves to Him and His rule? He has principles that apply to your life. And for many of us, we take the road of fools. All right. Let me put it to you this way. I found this great quote from Andy Stanley, and he describes this verse. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, like this. He says, wisdom begins when we recognize that God is God, and then we respond accordingly. Proper response, of course, is surrender. Once we have surrendered, God is more than happy to reveal more and more of Himself. So here's the situation. You've got to make a financial choice. You want to make a financial decision. Then you start looking in the Bible around what the Bible has to say about how to use your money. Not necessarily to give it to Him, but just how to use it. And you apply a principle that you've learned in the Bible, and then all of a sudden what God does is that, oh, you've taken a step here. Now I want to reveal more of myself to you. I want to show you greater wisdom. I want to give you greater wisdom as you move down this road to apply those financial principles. So that's what God does. And as we discover more and more of the character and the nature of the Father, we gain greater understanding of the world that he has created. Our expanded understanding results in an improved ability to choose wisely. Thus, true wisdom begins with a proper recognition of who God is, coupled with a proper response, surrender. God, I probably don't know how to do this the best way that I can. How do you want me to do this? That's surrender. God, I don't know what to do with my spouse. God, I don't know where to go with my job and my life. God, I don't know how to get out of the mess that I'm in. I'm going to surrender to you, God, and I'm going to ask you to give me wisdom. Now, if the idea of surrendering to God scares you, you're already doing this. You're already doing this now, today. You may not have thought of it before, but you are already surrendering to God in a lot of other areas. And so I just want you to take a step further into that. You see, because you are already surrendering to him when you make a wise decision, let's say in a relationship. Boy, that was a good choice. I'm so glad I did that. You are giving in to God's wisdom. When you make a wise financial decision, same thing is true. Every time you submit your body to the knife of a competent surgeon, you surrender to the laws of God because this person has studied the principles that apply to good health care, anatomy, and science. We have allowed that person to become wise in the God-given things in those areas. And so now I'm asking you to take a step into those other areas, believing that God might have wisdom for you to make wise decisions. Well, you say, well, maybe that's just good judgment. Yeah, but that judgment came from God. God intended for you to uncover it. God intended for you to learn it. He intended for you to grow in that so that you become wise. Here comes a passage from the book of Proverbs from chapter 8. I'm going to put it up on the screen. This is from chapter 8, verses 12 through 16. Here we have the book of Proverbs kind of personifying wisdom. Lady Wisdom is the person that you're meeting here today. Verse 12, I, wisdom, live together with good judgment. I know where to discover knowledge and discernment. All who fear the Lord will hate evil. Therefore, I hate pride and arrogance and corruption and perverse speech. Common sense and success belong to me. Insight and strength are mine. Because of me, kings reign and rulers make just decrees. Rulers lead with my help and nobles make righteous judgments. That's what wisdom does. Wisdom says, hey, the fear of the Lord is hating evil. That's another side of this. If you want to be wise, wisdom says, hate evil. Okay, now I'm wise. Gaining wisdom is knowing what's right and knowing what's wrong. That's what wisdom does as well. It helps you to understand wisdom and knowledge. All right. Biblical wisdom has a couple of things going on here. I want to describe for you some of the things that wisdom will teach us. Wisdom will make you smarter, right? Everybody want to be smarter, right? Have a be smarter. The difference, though, is that an IQ is different than being wise. How many of you watched Big Bang Theory? Come on. Guilty pleasure for a lot of you. Big Bang Theory. Sheldon is extremely smart, but he is not wise. Right? I mean, he just knows everything about everything, but he couldn't fight his way out of a wet paper bag, that guy. He is so smart, but he is not wise. Here's what happens. You can be a person of average intelligence, and you start reading this book, and you start absorbing the teachings that are in here, you will become wiser than Sheldon. And that will turn into intelligence. It's true, and I've seen this happen over and over again. The Bible even talks about it. The Pharisees looked at the disciples and said, what? These are fishermen. These unschooled men are schooling us on what the Bible says? It's because they were wise. They had wisdom that came from God. I mean, it's a great, great example. Wisdom also helps us discern right from wrong. Wisdom helps us in knowing what's righteous and what's just and what's equality. Just think about the flag coming down the, what's the state flag there? What's it called? Sorry? Confederate flag. Intellect would say there is so much more to that flag than racism. Intelligence would say that flag has nothing to do with racism. As a matter of fact, 8 states in the United States have some form or fashion of that flag in their state flag. But wisdom says there's been so much going on, and there's so many people that have identified with this, who identify themselves as being racist, and they identify themselves with that flag, that it's time to go. That's what wisdom says. Do you want to be wise? I hope you are, because being smart is not enough. See, here's what happens. When you become wise, this stuff happens to you in your life yesterday, and it impacts today. And when you're wise, you start to see the relationship between the two. And when stuff happens to you today, you start to realize and recognize that stuff into the future is going to be impacted by what I do today. Everything is connected. When you were wise, you recognize that everything is connected. So, for instance, just this past year in Alberta, the New Democratic Party swept the province. And in order to do that, they needed to have MLAs in all of the ridings. And they ran out of people to do that with. And some of the people that they put into those ridings, that won seats, they didn't get quite a good enough background check. There's a 26-year-old gal who gets elected in Alberta, and 5 years before, young people, pay attention. 5 years before, she takes a picture from a magazine of Stephen Harper and John Mulcair and puts two little bubbles and writes it on the magazine and inscribes or writes a dialogue that would indicate that they were gay friends. And then she posts it on her Facebook page. What she doesn't understand is that everything is connected, that the things that you've done in your past are going to come back and haunt you in your future. Then they find out that she's posing with a t-shirt that has a marijuana plant on it with a big thumbs up. And after the second picture comes out, the party leader has no choice but to say, "I'm sorry, you're done." Wisdom knows that the actions that you did yesterday are going to impact today. And the ones that you do today are going to impact you into the future. See, here's what a fool knows. This is a fool. A fool is not a simpleton. A fool is not someone with a low IQ. A fool knows what is right and does it anyway. Knows what's right and does the opposite. Sorry. A fool knows what it's right and doesn't care. That's a fool. And if you hang around with fools, you might become a fool, but you might not. But we deceive ourselves into believing, I won't do what they do. I won't hang out with them when that happens. I won't say those things. And this is not just for young people. This is for the rest of us at work, at lunch hour, with the people that we work with, the people that we hang out with on the weekends, the family that we have. If you hang around with fools, what happens is the fool is going to explode at some point. The actions of their past are going to impact their future, and the explosion of that will have an impact on your life because the shrapnel moves. And if you're in the way, you're gonna get burned. Your reputation is at stake. Your health is at stake. Your jobs are at stake. Don't stay with a fool. The Bible says this about a fool. A fool doesn't want to hear what's right. A fool won't thank you when you tell them the right way to go and the wrong way to go. They'll say, "I don't care." They're not going to walk up to you and say, "Gee, you know, I'm so glad you did that for me. Thanks. I'm not a fool any longer." A fool doesn't do that. In order to not become a fool anymore, we have to humble ourselves and submit to God and say, "Okay, God, it's not my way. It's yours." Understanding that there are consequences to our actions. Now, those of you who are parents and grandparents, your children, by nature, are foolish. Not because they're dumb or they're simple or they have a low IQ, but because they may know what's right and they don't care. They want to do their own thing, right? Mom says, don't hit your brother. Bam. Yeah. Dad says, don't do that. And they do it anyway. And it's your job to impart wisdom to them. Where are you going to get your wisdom from? From God. I got to tell you, there is so much in this book of Proverbs on raising kids that you would be flat out flabbergasted if you wrote down every verse that you found that talks about raising children. God wants you to have wisdom. My son calls me on the phone this week. He's 26 years old. He's kind of wise. He's getting there, but he knows that he's not wise in this one area. So he calls Dad on the phone and says, Dad, I need to process this with you. I need to talk it out. I'm thinking, boy, that is amazing that he's willing to do that. He says to me on the phone, Dad, I need a new place to stay. His job is 2 hours away. He has to find a new place to stay. He says, my buddy wants to buy a house, and then he wants me to move in with him. I said, well, that sounds like a good plan as long as the rent's okay. Well, no, he says he wants me to co-sign the mortgage with him because he's going to buy the house. Now, you all are going like that, right? But he's kind of thinking, this is a great deal. And I said to him, son, I said, don't do that. I said, because if, and maybe it'll never happen, but there's a good possibility that it might, that he gets sick or loses his job or in some way defaults on the loan, you are now responsible not only for what you pay him in rent, but his portion as well. Oh, I never thought of that. Because when you are wise, you recognize that the things that you do in the past impact the future, and then they impact the present, and then impact the future beyond. And I said to my son, be careful. Don't co-sign a loan. By the way, it's in here. Don't co-sign a loan. Here's a free one for you parents with growing up teenagers. Especially if they're in the young adult phase. They may come to you in the very near future and say, Dad and Mom, we'd like to buy a house, but we don't have the down payment. Can you co-sign a loan? Well, that's different, you know. That's my kids. It's my children. Let me give you some wisdom, please. If you are prepared to give money to your children and you are prepared to never see it again, then give it to them. But if you expect a regular repayment and you require that they fulfill all those obligations, you are going to be sadly disappointed. Because when they can't pay and they go on a vacation, you're going to be thinking, hey, wait a minute. That's my money you're spending. When they buy a new car and they can't pay the loan, you're saying, wait a minute, that was my money going out the door there. And there's animosity and there's conflict and there's resentment that you have for your children. Don't do it. Think about how the actions of the past are going to impact the future, the present and into the future. That's what wisdom does. A fool says, I know it's right and I don't care. Let me give you a couple of characteristics of the fool. There's a passage that, just like the first one that describes the wise woman, there's a foolish woman. She's called the adulteress, which comes from Proverbs chapter 9. It goes like this. Then there's this other woman. The woman named Folly is brash. She is ignorant and doesn't know it. She sits in her doorway on the heights overlooking the city. She calls out to men going by who are minding their own business. Come in with me, she urges the simple. To those who lack good judgment, she says, stolen water is refreshing. Food eaten in secret tastes the best. But little do they know that the dead are there. Their guests are in the depths of the grave. So here's wisdom, Lady Wisdom on the street corner. As we're walking by, she says, hey, come, I've got wisdom and I've got knowledge and discernment. Come and sit down and let me share with you wisdom. But Folly is also standing on the side of the street, watching as you go by and says, come, let me share with you. Don't worry about the worries of this world. I'll let you find an escape here and it'll all go away as you enter into the mortuary. Where death is and destruction. Now, maybe not literally, but the consequences of those things are eventually going to explode. And Lord, I hope that you're not a wise person hanging around with that fool when it does. A couple of characteristics of the fool. A fool is unrighteous, or basically the fool hates what is holy. A fool is not an idiot. A fool is not a stupid person. A fool just doesn't like holiness, doesn't like goodness and righteousness. A fool is unwise. They don't possess wisdom, the Bible says. The lips of the righteous feed many, but a fool dies for a lack of understanding. And they're not capable of understanding wisdom, says the Bible. The fool has no desire for wisdom and would reject it even if they could acquire it because he hates it. A fool is unrealistic. He's unrealistic about himself, about life, and about present realities. You know people like this. The fool says, I'm just waiting for that great investment so I can make the money that I need in order to get my business, right? They're always waiting for the next ship to come in. They're unrealistic about themselves and about their abilities and about their capacity to do something. They're just fools. They're completely deluded about what they can and cannot do. A fool is also undisciplined with his money, with his temper, and with her mouth. Those three things happen regularly. We're going to be talking about wealth and poverty next Sunday, and we're going to be talking about how to use be wise with your speech the Sunday after that. And then lastly, the fool is unreliable in his work and his words. We all know that there are foolish people that we could tell stories about, right? If I gave you 3 minutes, you could stand up here and either tell a story about how you were so foolish or that you were with someone that did something really stupid and foolish, right? When I was 15 years old, after church on Sunday, I went to my friend's house. He had a greenhouse, a big greenhouse in Burlington. And his dad was the owner of the greenhouse, and he was a little older than I was, so he'd just gotten his license at 16, and I still hadn't got it. And so he says, come on, I'm going to teach you how to drive. And so we got in this golf cart in the greenhouse. Now, back then, it was more so than it is today, but all the greenhouses were made of glass. You know where this is going, don't you? So I'm learning how to drive this cart, and I'm sitting like this in the driver's seat. If you can't see my feet, my ankles are crossed. My foot is underneath my other ankle. It's a very tight space. And my buddy decides that I'm not driving fast enough, so he takes his foot out of the box and leans over and stomps on the accelerator pedal. And of course, now I've got my other foot tucked in behind my other one, and I can't get my left leg out to hit the brake. And I panic and drive right through a glass wall. We could all tell stories of fools. I shouldn't have got into the driver's seat because I knew that my buddy was going to do something stupid. I should have known that his behavior in the past was probably going to be predictive of his behavior in the present. But my friend was just as foolish. If you hang around with fools, you're going to be impacted when their foolishness catches up with them. And so now he and I had to spend several weeks working at his dad's greenhouse to repair the damage and pay for the damage of the thing. Now, that's a little thing. But some of you today, you're acting like a fool. You think you know what's right, and you're refusing to ask God for wisdom. The plight of the fool is that they harden themselves to what God has to say. Some of you are behaving in ways and with patterns of behavior that are foolish in nature, and you're not willing to ask God for wisdom in those areas. You're thinking that your drinking is isolated, that you think that your eating is isolated, or your behaviors are isolated, that they're not going to impact your world or the people around you. And I'm here to tell you that that's not true. Seek wisdom. Be wise. Eat up the scriptures as best you can, because you don't want to be caught as a fool one day and regret the mistakes that you've made. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for blessing us with this day. But Lord, we know that blessings come with the principles of the universe and with everyday life and with living and abiding in obedience to your word. And so, Lord, we want those blessings to overflow upon us. We want those blessings to be part of who we are. And we can't expect, God, for you to bless us if we're not being obedient to your scriptures, to those wise sayings, to those wise people in our life who are trying to help us. And so, Lord, for the fool here this morning, it may not be everything in your life. It just might be one thing where you're recognizing now that I've made a mistake, that I've tried to do it my way, that I can't finish the job the way it is. I pray that God would bless you as you try to seek wisdom and understanding from the Lord. I pray that we would fear him in the right way, that we would be in reverent awe of who you are, God, as we submit to you. And so, Father, as we go through the rest of this service, I pray that you would speak to those hearts yet who need to be spoken to, that we would make a commitment to being on that journey of wisdom together. In Jesus' name, amen.